myself first. I've worked on private housing, I've worked for the Dread Volume House Builders, housing associations, I've even built council housing in Edinburgh. So I've worked across the sector. And also, as was said, been involved in policy. Housekeeping Scotland I drew up a year ago for the Commonweal. I led the government's town centre review, other things like that. And I'm involved in policy across housing. I sometimes worry there's more heat than light because there's a huge number of organisations looking at housing. And I'm trying to work in whatever way I can to focus on getting real possible outcomes over the general alarm and concern. Because we all know there's no doubt that we are facing a severe housing crisis. And I like to think that it's best understood not just as a single crisis, but as a series of overlapping crises, a kind of omni-crisis. And the three main places I see it in relation to my work as an architect are in construction, placemaking, and finance and delivery. And if you have to characterise what's wrong in these places, at the heart, we've done something extremely wrong that doesn't deliver. And on the back of that, we've kind of tried to fix it by putting add-ons that don't deal with the core issue and actually deepen the problem in the first place. So I want to think about what the core issues are, I want to think about what the fixes that have gone wrong and set out ways that we can reform in all these places. My main task is to talk about finance and delivery, but I wanted to touch on the other two, what I see as crises first. And the first is in construction. And the basic problem in construction is that our basic homes that we build have been engineered to be incredibly flimsy. That's a basic house structure, and it is really problematic in terms of its flimsiness, including the fact it's really susceptible to damp and rot. So instead of addressing that core problem, we basically try and tart up bricks to make it look solid and not as flimsy as it actually is, to deal with the look of the thing, and then to deal with the fact that we get rot inside the structure, particularly in sole plates. We basically wrap our buildings in polybags. Every home we build, 99.9% of the houses we build are basically wrapped in polythene, and that has enormous impact on our health. The water doesn't get out of the houses, the CO2 doesn't get out, the particulars don't get out, and there is a kind of time bomb happening in terms of the impact on our health and our children's health. So in terms of a reform, there's simple laws that we should follow. First of all, don't wrap us in poly bags. And secondly, Grenfell, of course, should be a turning point. And there's discussion in terms of Grenfell about how we need more sprinklers, more fire alarms, possibly, but they don't tackle the core issue of Grenfell. Most people died there through inhalation of toxic fumes. A basic law for housing, my basic proposal for construction reform is that we shouldn't build using materials that are toxic, that spontaneously ignite, that are plastic, that are not recyclable. We should just basically follow that. How that might work in housing, particularly in Scotland, we should use solid timber. We have a great resource of fast-growing engineered timber. We should be looking at off-site construction and building a new vernacular out of that. So I've used it for nurseries and then in conjunction with vapor open construction, use materials that draw the moisture out from the house, that wick it away through ventilation. So that's me building a nursery in Edinburgh, which is a lovely space, and the material at the end of the day is really, you see the structure, it's really hard weighing, it takes a knock. And additionally, it's inherently healthy. There's been studies done which show that children's heartbeat drops down when they're in a nursery that's made of timber. So that reflects into better behaviour, better concentration. All our homes should be like that. We should focus on health first. And here's some nice Scottish examples. Architects starting to look at engineered timber exposed internally. Down south, multi-storey versions, beautiful, calm spaces that really produce a new vernacular that we should be following. And all of this isn't fantastically expensive. I've used Maple Open Construction, building council houses for Edinburgh Council. They're standard tenements, they look sturdy, but there's no toxic materials, there's no plastics in there. It's healthy spaces, and you can breathe in these rooms like you can't in conventional construction. So, in terms of my first crisis, here's my proposals for reform. Simple list of don'ts and do's that we should put at the front of all our building regulations, all our housing associations, instructions, etc. My second of my three only crises is in placemaking. And this is where I grew up, in Greenbank in Edinburgh, number 96. And it's a place that is soulless. We're lucky we have a park around us, but the place is boring, it's no heart, it's no character. And because it is density is so low, it's a long way to any public facilities, to the shops, etc. We know that these places don't create communities, they don't nurture us, they're not creative, but we are still building, and we still want to build them maybe a bit tighter, but typical estates these days are all tarmac, tiny gardens, mostly overshadowed, no sense of belonging, no sense of view. The main Scottish Government way to try and tackle that has been a fix, which has not dealt with the heart of that, not dealt with the heart of the problem, designing streets. And it's a really strange document. It basically says, it does two Prince Charles influence things. One says, just make your streets wigglier and everything will be okay. I don't think that makes much difference. And it also, it does this horrible thing, it stops you allowing making cul-de-sacs and say you have to have traffic passing past your house. The two nicest places, the best communities I've lived, have been cul-de-sacs. It's the smallest component of community I know, and that's a dreadful thing. The second Prince Charles influence thing is about what, with apologies, the volume house builders have a technical term for these sorts of things, for the pediments, the half timbering, the cornices, which, excuse me, is goblins. That just tells you how they think about their work, that you put up a dumb box and you goblin it. And I once used this term in a newspaper article, and a senior house builder took me out for coffee and he said, "Malcolm, you don't realise how far on we've moved from that term." And I thought he maybe understood it's a bad thing to use. And he said, "We now do eco-goblins." So there's your eco-goblin. So that's trying to fix things without actually understanding what the issue is. And for the issue for me is that we are trying to make things look like this, and we end up making them, if your eyes are half closed, there's a wee similarity, but it turns into this very dull thing. We don't address the core. And for me, we can reform placemaking by looking at utilitarianism. That's the greatest good for the greatest amount of people. What made this community lovely was a simple concentration on simple utilitarian outcomes and patterns. Instead of trying to copy that, we should think about our simple utilitarian likes nowadays, which is generally about sunny places, connectivity between social gathering spaces. I think we can remake the planning system around such issues. When I've built buildings, I've always put them first. So this is a wee community I made on the edge of Edinburgh. It's rather wonderful because it's south-facing slope. Got views out to the Pentlands, got sunshine coming in. I put living rooms upstairs, family rooms downstairs, all family rooms facing south, all gardens facing south, north, garages and bedrooms. So it's all about sunshine and openness and views, connectivity to the Pentlands. A little village green at its heart, kids play. But because they're terrace houses, this is twice as dense as its rabbit patch, diddy box neighbours. But everyone also has social open space, gathering space. They have a view, they have sunshine, an openness to sunshine that these other places don't have. So I have tried to make it look old, but nevertheless it's been built around simple utilitarian values, which I think should be the heart of the planning system. Another example, which is just completely on site, social housing down in Leith Fort, council housing, Housing Association, instead of going for the standard developers' models, I've looked to reinvigorate our historic model. The colonies in Edinburgh are as dense as tenements that ever in a garden. They're the exemplar of social dense family homes in the city. Except their gardens don't get the sunshine, so I've taken out the thinking from my other project. I put all the gardens to the south. I've orientated them to collect sunshine and put village green again at the heart, tight closes between. So again, it's articulated by simple utilitarian values of sunshine, garden, place to kick a football, somewhere to have a barbecue with your neighbour. So my second crisis is then reformed by a reformed planning system focused on utility and well-being. The third crisis, which is the one I was supposed to have slated to talk about and ties in to previous speakers, is on finance and delivery. And basically, we don't build enough homes in Britain. We're way behind our European neighbours. But the graph, the statistic, and all the dreadful statistics about house building that terrifies me the most is the share of our GDP that we spend on housing benefit. That's UK, way, way above our European competitors. There's Germany down there. And that's a massive amount of money, as Sarah said, going from our taxes to the wealthiest people, to people who already own property. 25 billion a year. And the deficit in house building is entirely down to this ideological fanaticism for the private market and supplying all our building needs. And basically, we need to deal with that, as Sarah said, build public houses. But instead, we have concentrated on technical fixes, back to the existing models, help to buy, release the green belt, let the volume house builders get on with it. And the worst fix of all, the most evil fix of all, is to look at that graph and say, we're spending 25 billion a year on housing benefit. The way to deal with that is to squeeze people who are already distressed and poor and squeeze their housing benefits. That's the most shocking and evil thing to do. Whereas the best way to reduce that figure is to build council housing, public housing. That directly takes people off housing benefit and directly reduces that cost. So there's good economic reasons to do something which you know is correct socially. So, as Sarah said, back to a good post-war view of the value of providing for all. We need to be aware that everyone is going to get a mortgage, as we've hoped in the last 20 years as our economy has been built on. And indeed, the desire to do that really crashed the world economy 10 years ago. And it doesn't build enough houses, and it's a clear and present threat. Going back to trying to do that is worse than possible. There are, as I said, a huge number of current initiatives working on these things. And out of them, particularly the government thinks the Joint Housing Policy and Delivery Group that I sit on is their main driver. And I'm trying to get them to advance a series of seven steps that can be taken to improve finance and delivery. And this is my paper to the Joint Housing Policy and Delivery Group, which I'm going to outline those seven steps. And the first is national investment. We need a national bank. We need a national investment company. Common Weal's lobbied for that over 3 years. I've been lobbying for that as well. And rather marvellous, and I know Richard's been lobbying for that, and rather marvellously, the government has listened and announced the 5th of September that a national bank will be investigated. The devil will be in the detail, but that's a tremendous step. That sort of national investment going to all public infrastructure instead of public-private partnerships, and particularly into social housing with bonds between local authorities and government being the most efficient way to deliver social housing. Stalled sites, there are all over the place. The volume house builders say we need to release more land, but there are huge numbers of unbuilt bits of land with lots of planning permission. The reason they won't build on them is that they've land traded them back and forward as the market's risen, till they've got to a level where the market drops a little, they say it can't be built on, give us more farmland to build on. So all over the north of Edinburgh, for instance, there's empty land which has planning permissions which house builders won't get on with building on. How to get that moving? Well, the simplest way is, Professor David Adams will be talking in the afternoon, is compulsory sales orders, allowing local authorities to take land to market to be resold so the landowner gets a haircut and it's returned to a level at which it can be built on. That's a really powerful tool. The third thing that I'm asking for is how to fund infrastructure, and that is talked about all over the industry, all over government. They say we can't get on with this site because we can't pay for the school, we can't find money for the school, it's supposed to come from selling the housing, we can't build the housing until the school's there. In Edinburgh, how to get the tram out to new communities, how to build the health facilities, how to build the roads. The infrastructure is the biggest issue that house builders will tell you they are facing, or local authorities too. So in Edinburgh, for instance, what happens is if you convert an industrial area redesignated for housing, then the land will go up from maybe 15,000 an acre to 1 million an acre, and the people who own that land will make all the money. If Edinburgh expands, as we're told it has to, same again, the farmers' land will go up in value because it's redesignated from 15,000 an acre as agricultural land to 1 million an acre for residential land. All that money will go into the family trusts, probably much of it will go offshore, and it's lost to the housing market. So, we're told there's no magic money tree, but for me, in housing, that is the magic money tree. We've done work with the Built Environment Forum for Scotland and the Centre for Progressive Capitalism that shows in Edinburgh alone, in the next 20 years, there will be upwards of 10 billion released in land value that will go to landowners, except if, as Sarah say, you change the Land Compensation Act, local authorities can compulsorily purchase that land with the rising land value borrowed to put the infrastructure in first instead of the current broken Section 75 planning system. It's an incredibly powerful tool to use the value of the housing market to give government, local government, the tool and the finance to actually get it built. It's also an incredibly important powerful tool elsewhere. For instance, in Edinburgh, way outside the Greenbelt, it's going to be busted to build these film studios. You shouldn't go there where they create planning problems. You should go in the east end of Glasgow or Ravenscreen or somewhere like that. Where that sort of, if the government could persuade them to go there, it could then allow Glasgow to compulsorily purchase land around it because it would raise the value because other people would like to live around there. Powerful tool for regeneration, or as has just been announced, when Scotland's new benefits headquarters goes somewhere, it raises the value of land around about, which normally goes to land speculators. That needs to be harvested to support regeneration. My fourth step is to diversify supply. Even within private house building, you can diversify supply. We've talked about how Britain is addicted to debt. It's an economy built on debt. A normal house that you buy carries two levels of debt. The house builder has borrowed from the bank to buy the land and to build the house. And you borrow a mortgage on top of that. So there's two big slices of debt that every house carries. There is a way to do it with only one. When you build your own house, collect a self-build. So this is the remedy. So if you build self-build, most people think it's kind of grand designs, nice one-offs. But it can be done collectively. We've had a project in the Highlands which has done some ordinary stuff and some more visionary stuff. That if householder people who have mortgages pull their mortgages, they can commission buildings on their own, they can build on their own. That's how they, and you don't have the developer's profit, you don't have the developer's borrowing costs from the bank to build the house. That's how they build the continent. Half of the buildings on the continent are built like this. And you get really visionary, collective things that are done together, that have social facilities, that have live-work facilities, that have cafes, that have interesting stuff happening along it. And there's one marvellous example in Scotland. An architect in Portobello in Edinburgh put notice up in his local shop, got other people interested, buy the wee scraggy end of land, arrange the mortgages, and they're building this together, which is nearly complete. I've been trying and lobbying the government to roll this out across Scotland and start a fund, and I was told they were going to announce the fund, so I got really excited, but it's 90 grand. which makes Theresa May's offer look extremely generous. We need to support collective self-build. Glasgow's way in front in terms of keeping lists of people who are interested. But again, mostly it's the thought of the grand design's single plot. Collectively, we need to think collectively. We need to recover that ability in Scotland and do collective self-build. More diversification of supply within the public sector too. This idea that I'm suggesting that land value capture allows councils to take control of expansion like that, take the tram out there, put facilities in there, also allows them to divvy up the land and direct some of it be used instead of current landowners, bludgeon local authorities into accepting things. So in terms of providing space for co-ops, for co-housing, for intergenerational care, for old folks' housing, that would let the council lead to widen the sort of public sector initiatives from just the simple council house ones to a whole rainbow of people-centred active ways forward. My sixth step is in making best use of our existing resources, and in many ways this should come first, because we're always obsessed about new homes, but we should be using the ones we've got better, and we're not using them well. We're atomising as a society. We need to work out how to live together better. There's 34,000 empty homes in Scotland, which is terrible, given the number of homeless people there. The Scottish Empty Homes Partnership does great work, but needs further support, and we need empty homes officers in every council to bring back these flats above shops, etc., into use, sustain communities. It's cheaper than building a new home, it's more sustainable, it supports local services, it's the right way forward. Richard touched on VAT. The VAT situation is absolutely criminal. So all over Scotland you see situations like this. VAT house will be charged, whether it's listed or not, 20% to repair VAT, to repair that charge, and you're 0% to knock it down, 0% to build the new home beside it. It's a massive economic lever against the regeneration of our existing building stock. It needs to be levelled out. A foreign house builder told me that if that was in place, that if you put flat VAT across the sector, 5% new build and repair, they'd go away and not turn themselves into volume house repairers, which I thought was a really lovely term and a wonderful thing to do. We also need to get away, there's a kind of institutionalised contempt for the past we still have, which was most horrifically displayed for me in Dalmarnock, where for the Athens village, which is very good as far as it goes, they knocked down four streets of beautiful red sandstone tenements, say that they were kind of old and tired looking, and the people in them were kind of old and tired looking too. They didn't like that. They wanted their brave new world. We need to get beyond that sort of way. And of course, Glasgow is the worst place for it. Glasgow tears itself apart every 40 years, kind of condemns what's been done, moves people out. Architects and builders making enormous amounts of money building a new thing, then condemning it and talking about how to rebuild it and the proper urban form, etc., etc. And you out there need to understand that our industry is complicit in a terribly unsustainable way of viewing regeneration as a kind of landfill cycle as opposed to careful care and repair. And last of my seven steps is leadership, because we're not very good in Scotland at sharing information. There's lots of local authorities doing good things, but there's not enough coordination and direction from the centre in terms of a housing unit, Scottish Futures Trust being turned into a public investment company, an infrastructure commissioner, compulsory purchase orders coordinated across the sector, those sorts of simple leadership things. So that's my seven steps, and some of them, as you hear, are happening. I don't think any of them are pie in the sky and reasonable. There are people listening in various directions, and in all these different places that we're talking about housing, I'm trying to push them, particularly through Common Weal as well. And thank you for giving me the chance to talk about them, but the other crises in housing too. Thanks very much.